Good morning. I'm so glad that you're here with me this morning. Thank you for sharing these moments with me as together we're just opening God's word each morning before we start our days, and we're focusing our hearts and minds on the person of Jesus Christ. If you are joining me for the first time today, I'm so glad that you're here. Every day this summer, we're asking the question, who is Jesus Christ? And we are going to explore a different facet of his identity. The Bible uses so many different words to describe him. And so we're looking at, every couple of days, we're looking at a different facet, a different word, and seeing, kind of going down deep into scripture and seeing exactly what that word means. You know, earlier this week, if you're just jumping in, we looked back at the book of Genesis. We went back to the very beginning, and we saw that Jesus was instrumental in the creation of the world. John, the apostle, calls him the Word. We looked at that. We looked at the prophecy, the first prophecy in Genesis 3:15, and we see that Jesus is the promised seed that was prophesied in that chapter, and also the promised Messiah, the Savior. And so today we're actually looking at another facet of Jesus's identity. We're looking at the word Immanuel. Immanuel means that Jesus is God with us. Immanuel is a very, very meaningful name to us because God is not a distant, far away, detached God. He is a personal, present God. He is God with us. He is God with us right now in the midst of coronavirus, of a global pandemic. He is God with us in the midst of a world that is bursting forth in rage over racism and injustice in the world. We live in a broken world. There's no question about that. The world is desperate for healing and peace and justice. But even in the midst of this brokenness, God is with us. You know, a few years ago, I experienced a time when I really felt the presence of God with me in a very personal and powerful way. In 2015, I had the privilege of traveling to Rwanda with a fabulous team of women. My friends, Rhonda, Jamie, Ginger, Lisa, Darcy, we all went together to Rwanda to lead a women's conference, to lead a training, a leadership training conference in Kigali. And for 6 months, we gathered and we gathered together to pray and to bond and to share and to seek the Lord together. We all felt completely out of our comfort zones. We agonized with the Lord in prayer. We just sought him fervently to know what was it that we could share with these women that literally lived all the way around the globe. We felt such intimidation to go into a place and think that we had anything to share with women who lived a very completely different life than we lived. But we felt called to go, and we were invited to go. So it was an incredible privilege. Well, as the time drew near, so did the opposition. And my teammates especially were feeling a lot of opposition. A lot of things were coming against them as they busied themselves to prepare to leave their work and to prepare to leave their family for 10 days. But my preparations were going so smoothly. I had actually been to Rwanda the year before. I kind of knew where I was going, and I wasn't feeling a lot of opposition. So I spent some time kind of talking to the Lord about that and just saying, you know, God, I thank you for the smooth sailing that I'm having in preparing for this trip. And I started to think, well, what would it be? What would it really take for me to actually cancel going on this trip? Like, what kind of opposition would need to come against me that would actually derail my plans? And of course, I knew immediately what it would be. It would be if my son Adam got sick. If you don't know me, my son Adam is, he has Duchenne muscular dystrophy. He lives in a power wheelchair. He's an amazing, amazing young man, but he requires full-time care. And of course, he has a huge place in my heart as I'm by his side all day long, preparing, caring for him as a caregiver. So we have a very intimate relationship as friends also, but his life is extremely fragile, and it's unnerving for him when his main person, me, goes out of the country. And so I thought, well, and in this particular summer, in fact, we'd had a really rough summer with his health. We were trying to figure out why he was having such a hard time swallowing and eating and breathing. But it's just as soon as I had this thought that, of course, oh, if something happened to Adam, for sure, I would not go to Rwanda. Just then I heard the Lord whisper, trust me, trust me. Well, 2 days before we were set to go on this trip, Adam came down with a cold. Now, the week before, my husband had been on a business trip in New York City, and he'd come back with the worst virus he'd had in 5 years. So we were trying to keep the two of them isolated from each other, but it just seemed like this virus was knocking on Adam's door. Now, the reason that this poses such concern is that for a person with diminished heart and lung capacity, pneumonia is the number one killer. It is the worst enemy of an adult with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So Adam started to come down with his cold. I felt so torn about leaving, but I just pressed on, and I literally cried all the way as I drove to the airport that day because it felt so risky to leave him, and yet he wasn't really sick yet. Well, within a day or two of arriving in Rwanda, the text messages started coming in from my family that Adam wasn't feeling well. He was going to the doctor. Yep, he has pneumonia. Now he's going to the ER. They're waiting in the ER to get him admitted into the hospital. He's not doing well. And my mother's heart was just beating out of my chest because I'm literally facing my worst fear. I'm completely powerless. I can hardly communicate with my family back home because our days in Rwanda are nights in the US and vice versa. And so it's so hard to even communicate with my family. I'm getting little snippets of information. I know it's bad, but there's nothing I can do. And it's so strange that the Lord had actually prepared my heart for this moment because all I could do was trust him. That's all I could do. He was with me in Rwanda. He was with Adam in the hospital. He was like this satellite that knit us together around the world, and prayer was the beam that connected us together. I knew that God was with me in such a personal way. He was also really with me through my teammates. You know, they cried with me each day. They prayed with me. They bore my burden with me. You know, just in the same way that Jesus would have comforted me if he had been physically present with me. You know, what an incredible thing to have a God who is with us in times of hardship and suffering. That's why he's called Immanuel, God with us. Immanuel, he is God with us. Well, I won't keep you in suspense. Let me tell you the rest of the story. As difficult as that experience was, God really brought two glorious events out of this time. First, through the crisis of Adam's pneumonia, the doctors were actually able to figure out why he had been unable to eat and breathe all summer long. Turns out he had a fungal infection in his throat, and he had an inflamed esophagus, and he had a bleeding stomach, and he had pneumonia. So what appeared to be a crisis of health in that moment was actually the means to an answered prayer, because after a few days of testing and IV antibiotics, he got back to himself and was recovering and doing much better than he had before I left. But the second thing is that through the crisis of being a world apart from my family, when this whole event was happening, I was able to share my story real time about what I was going through in that moment with the women of Rwanda in the message that I spoke to them. I was able to tell them really candidly what it felt like to step out to serve the Lord as a leader. And it's not a promise of ease and success. In fact, really, really hard things happen that can rock you to the core. But God is with us, and he uses all of it for his greater plans and purposes. Now, of course, the women in Rwanda know so much more about suffering than I do. But there is one thing that we shared that night that crossed all language and cultural barriers, and that is a mother's love for her children. You know, God knew that through my challenging circumstance and my clinging faith, that he would accomplish his purpose by giving me and every one of my teammates a voice of encouragement to these women who are striving to lead in their churches and in their ministry at Africa New Life. So God is just, he uses all things. He is with us. And let me just ask you, in what area of your life do you just need to keep moving forward with faith and trust that God has a plan and a purpose for your life and that he will lead you onward? Because he is with us. After all, he is Immanuel. He is God with us. And he promises never to leave us and never to forsake us. So today, as you go out into your day, I want to ask you, will you allow him to draw near to you today and to actually meet you in the most difficult place that you're going to be today? whether it's a conversation with someone, maybe it's an area of trusting Him in a relationship or in your finances or in your marriage or with one of your children, whatever it is, would you just ask Him to be God with you today in the most difficult place that you are facing and just experience His promise that He will never leave you or forsake you. He is with you. Let me pray for you today. Father, we come before you with great praise and trust that you are God with us. You promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. You are with us, and you're with us in the most difficult places, and you're working behind the scene all the time in ways that we can't even discern. So give us the courage to press into the hard places and give us eyes to see that you are with us as we stand there. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, thank you. I hope that you are encouraged today as you go out into your day. Join me tomorrow as we're going to look at how God uses unlikely people to step out in faith and experience challenging circumstances in order to accomplish His greatest plans and purposes. And you might find that you also are one of those unlikely people, just as I am. So I look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning. Have a great day.